Alright, welcome back. Play 4 hours of Kyoto Ring Grand Prix Long with Boothius Kane here from Kyoto Ring Grand Prix Long. Approaching the 12-hour mark. Halfway. And this isn't like a football match or anything. There will be no halftime intermission. The race keeps going. The clock keeps on ticking. It is man and machine against the metronomic beat of the clock. And, Steve, it has been a pretty exciting race so far.
Yes, indeed. There's been plenty of action throughout the field, especially the fight for the leading positions overall in the pro category. We've had a number of cars that have had minor setbacks. Partly through mistakes in pit stops or more mechanical issues, but they've managed to fight their way back, and we've had a number of cars that have been in contention for the lead of this race throughout.
It is Sunday morning, very early morning for those in Europe. Sunday afternoon for getting to be Sunday afternoon anyway for those in Australia. And it is getting to a late Saturday evening for those on the east coast of the US. Anyone on the west coast of the US with us or tuning in? It's pretty early in a Saturday evening, so it's just around dinner time for them. These times on serious business, aren't they?
Indeed, and that's one of the key things for a team trying to participate in this race, trying to manage the time zones and manage the drivers, who's going to drive when, because many of these teams, in fact the majority of these teams, will have a majority of European drivers within them, and so they've got to manage who's going to be up in the graveyard shift, as it were, as it is pretty much right now, doing those stints, and who's going to get a chance to sleep.
And you know, I think it was mentioned earlier when Mr. Passingham was here, the fact that LFS doesn't have day-night-day transitions kind of screws with your clock, because you know, you can look out your window, it's dark, but in LFS it's daylight. But actually, if this were the real time of the race in Kyoto, Japan, it would be about this bright outside. It's, you know, since they're almost half the world away, this is what it would be like in Kyoto, Japan right now, and we'd be starting and finishing the race at dark 30.
Indeed, that's where this race does, or where for racing on Infospeed does from real life, because a part of getting through a real life 24 hours is you reach milestones, like you reach sunset, you reach daylight, small things like that. But of course you don't have that here, you just have constant daylight. So it's, I guess it must be quite disorientating in a sense, when you just drive around and you don't have a sense of, you don't have that feel for what time it is and how far you've got without looking at the clock. Speaking of how far we've got, we are 5.5 minutes from the halfway mark. We've almost gone once around the clock. We've got one more round to go.
You know, speaking of the sunset, sunrise, you know, I was watching a little bit of the 24 Hours of Daytona, and that sunset last weekend was just gorgeous.
Oh yeah, indeed.
And of course, you know what it's like to be at an endurance race for all those milestones. You were at the Le Mans 24 Hour race last year as a spectator.
I've been for the last 3 years, yeah. Yeah, it's Le Mans and Daytona, to compare them in that sense, they are very, very different in that, in regard to the nighttime hours, because Daytona's in the mid, at the end of January, and they have about 13 and a half hours of darkness, whereas Le Mans is held very as close as possible to the summer solstice, so you only get about 7 hours of darkness. It's a completely different concept behind racing through the night at those two different events.
Well, and you know, with Daytona, it has artificial lighting, which they, you know, they don't run at full power, but they run at like, what is it, 35% or 40% power or whatever. So the drivers still have to rely on the headlamps, taillights on their actual cars. But having that advantage of plenty of artificial light about makes it a whole lot different than Le Mans, where you've got hardly any light back on the back section of the circuit, you know, on the Mulsanne straight all the way down towards Arnage, Indianapolis.
Indeed, I mean, there's more lighting than there would have been 20, 30 years ago at Le Mans. Certainly around the pit complex and around the permanent parts of the circuit, up Dunlop Curve, the Forest Estes, etc., where there is sufficient lighting for the spectators to get around and read to identify the cars in some regard. But of course, yeah, out on the public roads, down the Mulsanne, down to Indianapolis, it is still very dark. It's a completely different film what you get at the super speedway at Daytona, where you've got the oval lights. Like I said, they're not full power, but they're not dim.
They, as Garbaleski has a spin coming out of turn three. You know, at turn three, kind of the way you fade away, fade towards the outside of the track, it does make it pretty easy to clip the grass and do a quick 360 or two. You know, actually, one thing too at Le Mans, they do have several of the marshal posts. They do light fairly well, so the marshals can see what they're doing, and the marshals can be seen a little better.
Indeed, but that's an important aspect of a race such as that. You got to provide adequate lighting for the corner work effects in the States would call it. And yeah, that's an important part of determining where it's lit and by how much.
But yeah, it's, you know, one thing. So, when you go to Le Mans, do you have the assigned seat, or do you have the kind of general admission thing where you can pick your vantage point around the track as the clock wears on?
Do you mean me personally, or what's available? Well, I personally get an assigned seat in one of the grandstands. I've been on the main straight opposite the pits, but there's a lot of general areas for spectators to get around. There's many different vantage points around the permanent parts of the circuit. It won't let you near the Mulsanne straight, for example, but you can get around a fair amount of the circuit. Even if you just have a general admission ticket.
What is the atmosphere like on that race weekend? What if anyone watching this may be considering going, or going for the first time this year, or someone like me who does want to go to the Le Mans 24 Hours one day, you know, when money and time allows. What is it like to be there as a spectator?
Well, I'm not sure who said it, but someone once said, nobody goes to Le Mans once. and I can vouch for it's a very special atmosphere. I mean, the way many thousands do it is in the campsites. You get the real, that sort of campsite atmosphere, a real party atmosphere for those who like that sort of, but it can be quiet as well. And in terms of when you're at the circuit, at a race, it's a fabulous atmosphere. It really is, especially around the time of race start, race finish. The stands are absolutely packed. There's about a million people there. They come from around the world as well. Super.
Well, you know, Steve McQueen in his Le Mans movie, and one of his quotes from that movie was, "Racing is life. Anything before and after is just waiting."
And, exactly. You know,
you have these events like Le Mans, like the Indy 500, like the Daytona 500, like the Monaco Grand Prix that are the perfect personification of that line, that saying.
Exactly, it's the tasting of speed, it's the excitement. I mean, those events you talk about, Le Mans, it's the great challenge, it's all the fabulous cars, the diversity of cars, it's the atmosphere in the Indy 500, it's the insane speeds, the wheel-to-wheel racing, Monaco Grand Prix, but being on the streets of Monte Carlo at insane speeds. These sorts of races really do are the jewels in the crown of what of the sport that we all love.
Yeah. And speaking of our crown here, the 24 Hours of Kyoto Grand Prix Long, we've just a couple and a half minutes ago crossed over the halfway mark. So 12 hours and 2 minutes 45 seconds gone, and just under 12 hours to go. I think I will take this time to go through a race order. NX Racing leads Robin Friskaps at the wheel. He's on his 314th lap. That means he completed, let's say, 312 in the first 12 hours. So that means right now we're on pace for about 625 laps. Without safety cars, I think we were kind of looking at a maximum possibility of 247, so I think we could still reach about 235, 240. We had those couple safety cars that slowed down this first half, so I think we could be close to 630, 635, but as he is working his 314th circuit, NX Racing leads from Team Virus, Terra Mind Factory in 3rd, Genuine Racing in 4th, 5th, Stig Breeding Program Pro, 6th, Conquest Racing Pro, 7th, Ixion Sim Sports Pro, and 8th, Core Racing Pro number 2, Infinity Esports Pro, 9th. They are doing quite well to stay as close to the lead battle as they are after having not one but two timeouts from Dennis Lind. 10th is the Hellenic Racing, which is the first amateur car, and they are the highest placed FXR. And, you know, as has been mentioned before, you don't usually think of Kyoto Grand Prix Long as a FXR track. We'll discuss that a little after the rest of this round. 11th, Stig Breeding Program Amateur. 12th, Core Racing Pro number 1, Team Rock Racing in 13th. Vortex.eu in 14th. Last Lap Motorsports 15th in their amateur effort. Green Angus Racing in 16th. Infinity Esports AM 17th. Team Virus AM 18th. Savage Sim Sports 1 19th. Scuderia Gas Racing Team 20th. 21st. Conquest Racing AM. Green Angus Racing number 2 Squad 22nd. ASEX 23rd. Last Lap Motorsports 24th. Team 6th A Fondo in 25th, Savage Sim Sports, the last car running, in 26th, Savage Sim Sports 2. One retirement, the Merida Racing Team. They retired in the early parts of the race, about 2.5, 3.5 hours ago, after a flip at the corner 9-10 area, and the world-class Lions team did qualify, but they ended up with pulling out of the race just before the start. But yeah, as mentioned, you know, we had a good discussion with one of the Hellenic Racing team members about, you know, their ability. They have gotten quite lucky with the two safety cars that we've had, but to keep the FXR where they've been does take a big amount of skill.
Indeed it does. I mean, like I said, they have had a fair share of luck, and that's what you need in one of these races, really. The fortune with the early safety car especially, and there was the incident, a couple of incidents that they've had coming into the wall, but they've got away without damage. But that's what you need. But yes, the track really is not suited to the FXR. It's four-wheel drive, but lack of overall straight line speed does not work as well as the XRR and the FZR around here. So it's a very impressive effort nonetheless for them to be in such a commanding position in the amateur category, and so high up in the overall classification as well.
But of course, the same safety car regulations that did help them, just based on the way they fell where they were, can also hinder them just as easily.
It could as well, and that, like I said, that's luck of a draw, really, and it's the way the cards fall, as it were. If you're doing that well, if you're performing that solidly in a car that's just not suited to the combination, and you're right up there at this stage of such a long race, then you deserve to have a bit of luck on your side, really. And massive respect to them for putting themselves into this position.
NX Racing putting a very commanding performance in now after some early issues, including a speeding penalty and just a couple of issues in the first few hours of the race. But that's one other thing about these long races, the 12 and 24, is the fact that you have plenty of time. If you have problems early, you have plenty of time to adapt your strategy, to think, and to try to make the right decisions to come back. You do have a little time to try some alternative things, but, you know, as these minutes tick away, your decisions have to be quicker. You have to know what works and what doesn't the later you get in.
Indeed, I mean, for NX as the example, they led the opening hour, not by much, but over the Conquest Pro Car, I believe. They managed to hold on to the lead, and when they came into the pits, I think it was, I'm not sure it was in the car, it might have been Isaac, it might have been Matteo Vignali, who got caught speeding entering the pits, and I think it was Vignali who had steering wheel problems when in the pit lane. That set them back there at the time. I think put them to 8th place after the cycle had stopped. They just kind of just got on with the job and did what they do best, which is drive very quickly, and they managed to get themselves back right up into contention, and now at the halfway stage they're in a very good position, having a solid lead at the top of the timesheets.
Of course, two more rounds left after this double points 24-hour race. Let me pull up the schedule so I can actually tell you the dates they're on. Next is the 6 hours of South City Long, which is always an interesting combination, with the walls not at all far away, very close. It's the South City is kind of the Monaco of LFS minus the yachts, minus the expensive accommodations nearby, and minus the fact that it's quite close to France. Just the 6 hours of
South City, it's a very different prospect to what we've been experiencing today. It's going to be a lot of bumping and banging on the walls. It's going to be a lot more favourable than here to the FXL with its slower corners, which the FXL's four-wheel drive really benefits from. So goodness knows what Hill Electric Racing Team can do at a track that actually suits their car, but it's going to be a very interesting challenge indeed, and a relative sprint race compared to what we've got today, so we'll see if that changes the mindset of any drivers.
Yep, indeed, and the series finale will be on April 13th. That will be the 12 hours of Aston Historic, and that will be the longest circuit length on the calendar. This race is the second longest at 7.377 kilometers. Aston Historic, 8.089. Of course, Aston Grand Prix being the longest circuit in LFS, but you know, the FXR will have its last real chance to shine easily at South City. 1.5 times the points also on offer for the 12 hours, and you know, Aston Historic is very fast. You have to have the that nice tricky high downforce section in the Aston North sweeper sections, but then you have very long, very fast, flat out straight, so it's a big challenge to set your car up for that track.
And it is. That's one of my personal favourite track configurations in the whole of LFS. It's very fast track indeed. It's got some very tricky sections as well. The Dipper or Eau Rouge, whatever you want to call it. It's got the sweepers in the north section, and it's got the chicane as well. It's a great challenge, but very high speed, and it'll be interesting to see what these guys can make of it over 12 hours. Joined in the commentary box now by Timo Huben of NX Racing. Good morning, Timo. How's the race been going from your perspective?
How are we doing today, gents? It's actually still night here. I haven't gone to sleep, so it's not quite morning yet. But yeah, the race start was pretty clean until Matti's wheel decided to fail in the pits. We got shuffled down quite far down. And since that, the guys have just done a really good job on working their way back up to the field, up to the point where they are right now. Pretty decent lead. Just controlling the race, not trying to make any major mistakes, stuff like that. So. But I mean, it's a really long race, and still 12 hours to go, so anything can happen. It's not over until she sinks.
Indeed, but you must be very pleased with being in the position that you're in with such a solid lead at the halfway stage of the race.
Yeah, for sure. You guys have done an awesome job keeping calm. It's one of the problems that we've had before, especially in these long races, that when something goes wrong at the start of the race, it easily gets not depressive, but like bad energy. So we kind of tried to tell the guys before the race that if something happens at the start, just try and stay calm. It's a really long race, anything can happen. So. Misfortunes we had at the start, we never lost a temper and just and kept working our way up and to where we are now. So how are you doing today, Steve? Are you managing
this? Yeah, I'm doing okay. It's this stage of a 24-hour race. It can be quite tricky to get through. Once you get to the morning, it's usually quite a bit easier. But you know, it's the long graveyard shift, as it were.
Yeah, I know exactly what you mean. Seems like most of, or almost everyone is pretty much in a bit of like some mode at this point. It's probably gonna get worse a few hours until it starts to get better again. We just need to try and fight our way through these really hard hours. So I'm gonna be most likely staying up for the whole race as well. I'm not driving myself, but I said to the guys to help with whatever they need, so I'll try and stay up for the whole race as well. So we just need to make sure we keep each other company so we can stay up until Chris and Oscar gets back.
Indeed. So how much does the mindset of the team change when it's 24 hours in front of you instead of what we've had so far this season, where it's been 3 hours, 6 hours? How much does your approach alter when it's 24?
Well, I guess the biggest difference is probably the preparation. Such an important race, you want to make sure that the drivers and setups are best condition, so to speak. But other than that, I think it's always the same mental approach on the race, just trying to do the best and minimize the mistakes and try and win the race. It's not really any different. Even if it's just a 3-hour race or a 24-hour race, you always want to win and make the best out of it. Just for the record, I think the TV director thing has been stuck on our car for quite a while now. I personally love the skin, of course, on the car, but would have been nice if I could see some of the cars as well. I don't know who's in control of it.
That's me. I've been trying to do quite a bit at once. And
Let's see if we can find some battles on the track here.
Yeah.
Because Elton is probably going to go for a pass here, but he's a lap down. It's not the position, so... we do have a pretty close battle for P11 between Core Racing Pro 1 and Team Rocket Racing. Marcus Gunzelmann versus Tommy Oscar.
Let's go and take a look. Given how NX Racing did the point standings, and that this race is worth double points towards the championship, you must surely see yourselves as being in a very strong position for the overall and pro titles. City or Aston in the final rounds?
Most likely not. Kind of driving iRacing at the moment, so we already have so many good guys in our vessel, so probably won't even be able to outpace them. Which is starting in March, so we're not performing. symptoms. Because it takes just it takes the racing to a whole level when everyone has to work pretty much on the same setup, and you have to get it to be tweaked for several drivers instead of your personal setup, so to speak. And I think Tommy Oskar is going for a pass on core here for P11. I think he made it stick in the last corner.
Indeed, we've also got Matt Kingsbury with some very heavy left side damage on his AM car. He's eventually managed to make his way back to the pit lane, but that's going to take a while to get that repaired.
I think Marcus actually hit the wall at entry as well. Yeah, he's fixing damage now. Did he get a puncture or something? Maybe in the last couple of corners or something. He seemed to run really wide on the pit entry, then straight into the wall.
I'm not sure. I was keeping an eye on Matt and his damage.
This race has been so up and down. I'm really like surprised by how many lead changes and everything there has been, especially with our own problems and then Tomek's problems with a pop-up I think he got or something like that, and the other team's timeouts, etc. So it's been a really up and down race. Maybe this is like the first time in the whole race that feel is sort of spread out and people are kind of in their own positions at the moment.
But indeed,
probably gonna see a safety car with 20 minutes to go of the race, like always. So the gap that we have to everyone right now, the banner in the end, anyway. But with our luck, it's gonna be like that.
Yeah, I imagine something like a late station car. Would probably throw a massive spanner into the works. But yeah, it has been a very interesting race out front, especially the opening hours, very competitive for him. Oh, and we've got, I'm not sure which car that was, someone got hit. That's Wong, the number 66, Green Angus car. That's why someone got into the final corner. Got tapped by Tommy Oskard, I'm told. There are a lot of it's a fair share of issues among the different cars. Like the Unitz car had the trouble at the first pit stop. There's been a number of issues of timeouts and things. It has kept it very competitive. But yes, this is the first time it's been. It's properly settled down.
Yeah, and especially these night hours that we are approaching right now are probably one of the most important hours in my opinion, where you just have to make sure you minimize all the mistakes and just keep a really clean car and consistent pace through these really horrible hours to drive. Many times I've always done these hours myself, so I know exactly how exhausting it is, since you are basically the driver who does these hours is also there at the start, so he's already sitting and waiting for 12 hours until it's his turn to race, and it really takes a toll on you mentally and physically to just sit there and wait. Then once you get in the car, you pretty easy to get tired right away. It's hard to focus and concentrate on exactly what you need to do.
Indeed, and that's one of the crucial things about a race as long as this, keeping your concentration, keeping your focus, and not making those little mistakes that pile up to cost you lots of time, or even making a big mistake can really damage your race.
why is one of these rescue cars not on the track? Is there someone stuck somewhere? Or is it just... Oh yeah, it's
just moving around. And there's
go home, Deku, you're drunk.
I think he's just getting his position to cover in case something does happen in further around the track. But
yeah, I don't
to have the gap between second and third overall closing up. It's now under 5 seconds between Sean Liddon in the Virus Pro car and Schneider's in the Terra Mine Factory car. That's 4.9 second gap at the second split.
Yeah, I think we're going to see a battle between Hellenic Racing and Team Rock Racing before that. Tommy Osgood is right up on the tail of Kodu Rockies. I'm sorry if I cannot pronounce that surname at all. But Hellenic Racing car, I believe that is.
Yeah, that's correct. The class leader in the amateur category.
Yes, that would be for 10.
Then the gap was under 6 tenths of a second at the line that time around. Oscar taking a look at the inside of the Hellenic Racing Team car. He's on the outside going through the oval section. He knows he's not going to be able to make a move around there yet, so he comes back in for the slipstream and he's down the inside for what will be the inside for the Bluefish chicane. It leaves enough room and he gets it done on the brakes. So Tommy Oscar is up to 9th place overall. Which means the top 9 are now all pro cars. And he's managed to, at least for now, make the move stick. And he comes straight into pits after that. It looks like Tommy's going to stay in the car for another stint. Also in the pits is the number 60, that's a Savage Simsports car, I believe. It's got Raoul Zapp at the wheel.
Just had a couple of yellow flags caused Benjamin Kilicki having having an issue at turn 3, and not too far away as the crow flies, but a long way away as the track goes. Christian Kistner was having a bit of a twirl around at the turn 10 area.
And contrary to what I said before, Thomas Gard did get out the car, and it's Joe Littorello who has got back in the number 06 team up racing car. Back up in 11th overall, lost a couple of places due to that stop.
So Steve, I know you're going to the Indianapolis 500 this year.
Yep.
Yeah, I went to Carb Day last year. One thing, the amount of, aren't you going to be staying close to downtown Indianapolis?
Yeah, fairly close.
When I got to Indy on the Friday of Carb Day, there were so many campers, so many people just sat in front of their yards on Crawfordsville coming in towards the speedway. And just the amount of banners and decorations, the amount of everything, just on Carb Day. It was like, if it's like this on Carb Day, what's it like on race day? One of my friends from Ohio University is a big motor racing fan, and one of his things is any motor racing fan of any form of motor racing must go to the Indy 500. He calls it a holy experience.
Indeed, and hopefully I'll be seeing that one through in a few months' time, end of May.
Keeping an eye on the battle for second between Sean Leland and Marcus Schneiders, and it seems like the gap is coming down about a couple of tenths every lap.
Indeed, a few laps ago it dipped under 5 seconds, now it's more like two and a half. Oh, Sean Leland's off.
Yeah.
He's put off. It on the grass on the exit of the final chicane. Across to quite a bit of momentum and a bit of time as well.
This is just these kind of mistakes that I was talking about, these small mistakes, but when you keep repeating mistakes like that, in the end it costs you quite a lot of time. It's just mentally and physically getting tired, and it's just really easy to lose the focus for just that half a second and a mistake happens.
Exactly.
Schneiders just had a bit of a mistake, which lost him a bit of time at turn 2. He hit the curb wrong.
The gap between these two was 1.2 seconds at the line. And Schneiders has lost half a second in that first split. A very costly mistake.
By the way, don't forget, If you've got any questions or anything for us, you can ask in the official NDR IRC channel. That's Octothorpe hashtag NDR at irc.gamesurge.net. There's a link to the IRC tracker. You can also ask in any of the threads in the forum. Unfortunately, I don't have a Twitter account that I'm using actively, so I'm sure Steve can give out his again to if anyone wants to ask us questions. It does help to fill these small hours of the night.
Well, if you've got a question, if you want to send it my way, it's at SafetyCarSteve on Twitter.
May I actually ask, Steve? I probably wasn't around with LFS back then, but I'm not sure. I remember why you're called Safety Car Steve. There are probably viewers out there who don't know that either, so do you mind explaining that?
Basically, originated from a small, where I was around a bunch of people who were in a small private league, and then one time I just went and said, I want to drive a safety car, I don't want to race, I want to drive a safety car. That nickname was given, and it stuck, the nickname was probably given by Chris Ford, and I guess that stuck.
Oh, okay, well that explains it. I always thought that you were called Safety Car Steve for a reason, that you might have crashed into the safety car or something like that.
Fortunately not.
A la Montoya style.
Now, that wasn't the safety car, that was the jet dryer.
I know.
Gap is just around half a second or so, three quarters of a second now between Schneiders and Lydon, and it is getting ever so closer. Schneiders puts a couple wheels on the grass exiting the Bugley chicane.
Looking at the tyres, I do believe that Schneiders will be pitting first of these two, and it probably won't be too long. I'm not sure when they last pitted, but I imagine Schneiders will be in slightly earlier.
Report from Momo in the IRC channel, apparently Sean is getting quite tired, which, he's been in a lot this early part of the race.
Yeah, I imagine so. That's exactly what Timo was talking about before. It's about keeping the concentration, and if you can't keep concentration, then these mistakes can happen, or you're losing the pace, perhaps because you're trying to avoid making the mistakes. So you're just a bit too cautious.
Yep. There's a bit of a gaggle between 69, the Hellenic team, 56 from the Savage Cars, and 05, the LLM Pro Car. And I don't see anything for position in this. One thing about Sean, he has done 162, 163 of the team's lap. He's done about 50% of what the team has done so far. He's still got plenty of time to get under the 45% limit for this. Yeah, I do think Schneiders will be pitting earlier than Sean. Last pit 54 minutes ago for the Mine Factory car. 56 minutes, excuse me, 45 minutes ago for Team Virus, so they've got about a 10-minute spread there, which is about 4 or 5 laps. But again, though, if you can get around them before you have to pit in, That just means you're that much closer, assuming you don't mess up the pit stops. And that's about, that also means that they could come out much closer, depending on how pit stops go. Of course, Schneider's can gain the place.
Schneider's could have the draft here.
Just, oh, Sean lagged again. Remember, he's lagged earlier.
Might be enough. Nope, he's not going to get through that bar.
And he's had a little bit of twitch there, so Sean will pull ahead, and Schneider's will not have the draft going down the back straight. But through the sweeps, if he can stay close and then get a draft around on the oval section and hold him behind between the Boothie chicane and the final corners.
Another battle to keep our eyes on is the battle for fifth place between Genuine and Ixion. Dominic Engel and Elton Chong. They are separated by just a couple of tenths.
Yes, in fact, that's looking a little closer than our Schneiders and Williams battle as Chong comes around to the right side of Engel. Engel has the prime line for this corner. He slides up. They make a little bit of contact. Chong, of course, being of the Chinese area, so they'll have by default a little higher latency, which can increase the chance of a light collision, which is about what happened there, so he'll have to sit behind and try another issue. But again, if you have, and I think Timo, you can kind of attest to having to deal with people that are laggy, it's a little more latent, the fact that you have to be careful when you're trying to overtake them.
Yeah, of course. The only problem is it's kind of hard to think about that in the heat of the moment. It's really easy to forget that once you start battling side by side until it's too late. But I hope this. I think Elton is aware of his
height. Schneiders goes to the left side of Lydon as they head into turn 16. Schneiders should be in the pits this lap. Felix Hillen has connected. They make contact! They make more contact! And they're both slow. Looks like Lydon survives it. Actually, Schneiders stays out another lap. A bit of a horn coming from Schneiders. Close action.
And now Schneiders gets ahead before turn one. Watch out for Lydon trying to get a run into turn three. If he can get close enough and get the slipstream. Which I don't think he can. But Schneiders gets the position.
And meanwhile, that was happening, Elton Chong, who's way further into his stint, managed to get around Dominic Engel for fifth, but he should be heading into the pits pretty soon, so.
While we're looking at that, Chong has gotten around Engel, and Friskops is about to lap Engel, so he's going to have all but the top five lapped here shortly. Schneiders is still around Lydon, so he'll be ahead and can try and pull up a little gap before the pit stops. So, Timo, what are some of your expectations, not only for your own team, but for the remaining 11 hours of this race?
Well, I think just the main importance is just to minimize the mistakes right now, since we are in a pretty good position, and just hope that there's no late safety car that takes all the gap away. But you know, it's still a long race to go. Anything can happen, so it's too early to say anything. But it's looking good so far. Robin and Isaac has done a really good job during these hard hours to not make so many mistakes, so it's looking good.
Just looking, might be pitting next. Ixion SimSports Pro in 5th should be pitting in a lap or two. They have gone about 56-57 minutes since their last stop. Also, Infinity Esports Pro, also about that same amount of time. And then Team Virus lit up 52-53 minutes since the last stop. Of course, that is all available of the tracker at tracker.newdimensionracing. Felix Hillen into the car from and Chong has put it off. Couple tires off, exiting turn 4 into the turn 5 area at the sweeps. His tire's getting cold. Looks like a little bit of a time trying to hang on that. I don't know, that may have just been his lag. Our race leader Robin Friskups comes around. That little mistake may let Engel catch him up. The night wears on here in Lipper Speed on the 24 Hours of Kyoto Grand Prix Long, just coming up on another round of pit stops. 3:54 in the morning at UTC, that'd be 4:54 Central European Time. 5:54, a little further east in Europe, it is 5 till 11 p.m. here on the east coast of the United States of America. So for anyone still up at this late hour in Europe, thank you for being with us. Anyone who's just waking back up, who may be on the Asian side of things, where this track is located in its kind of virtual reality environment. It's situated in the Kyoto Prefecture of Japan region. Good morning to anyone who is just waking back up and joining us. Anyone who might be taking their bow out from us for now, good night to you. We will be still here throughout the checkered flag in about 11 hours and 5 minutes time.
So, Deco, may I ask you a question? And how do you think this race has progressed from your point of view as the race director?
Lived
up to your expectations for being such a long race so far?
I think it's, for some reason I thought we'd be a little busier, but we've been staying fairly clean, so the protests haven't been light. You know, I thought with some of the action in the early couple of hours we'd been bombarded with protests, but they've come in pretty balanced, only a couple here, a couple there. The fact that we did have the people and the ability to recover those cars hot from the gravel and not scramble a safety car, partly due to the fact they were in a fairly easy place and we had gaps to reach them in. And oh dear, it looks like we have a man with a wrongly formatted name. got the totally wrong format. He has a white number and then a multicolored name, and the format is actually blue number for professional, green number for amateur class cars, and all white for the remainder of your name. And it looks like he's realized it. Been told to disconnect, fix it, and then rejoin with hopefully the correct name to avoid incurrence of a...
See if he makes it back onto the server in time to take over the car.
Then he's still partly wrong. I'll have to consult the rules on that. And oops, that's not gone well. He left the pits, they didn't take over, and Chong has a drive-through penalty.
Ouch, that's gonna hurt their chances quite a lot. These sort of mistakes are also a bit silly to make. You should be fully aware of exactly what sort of name format you need to have when you join the server, so you don't get these sort of surprises. And it obviously made a huge impact on the race at this moment. At this point, having to get a drive-through penalty from probably being under stress there, he never joined in time, so Elton decided to keep on going and got stressed and accidentally sped in the pits, and now he has a drive-through. So it's these sort of mistakes as well that you can't afford to do these. It's so simple to manage to not get it if you just have everything in check.
You know, the fatigue does weird things to your mind and body, so kind of makes your reaction time just a little slower. By the way, one thing I'd like to do is thank the people that have helped. Stuart so far, an admin, John Provost, Jack Atkinson, Michael Booth, Timo Hinyan, Stuart Baker, Timo and Stuart being the safety car drivers, pretty much everyone helping take a look at some of the protests as we've gone through. Joe Letteriello has been around helping. Had a pretty full crew as the race started in the first several hours, and hopefully we'll get that many people for the last few hours of the race when the daylight is up for most of
them. Elton Chong in the pits to take his drive-through penalty. He will not be able to make the driver change this lap, so see if he decides to go in next time and hand over the car to Michelle. I believe that is his name. Or
James Peace connects to take over from Mr. Sean. You know, one thing on the topic of the amount of 24-hour races, because of how few of them there are in LFS, the high proportion of them have been at Aston Grand Prix. This is one of the few that has been elsewhere. I don't think there have been many, if at all, at... Wong, for Angry Angus Racing. Spins coming out of turn 16 directly in front of Robin, and I don't know if you were hearing anything Robin might be saying, Timo, since you're one of his teammates. Right in front of him could have been a little bit of a hard stop.
Yeah, you see, anything can happen. Seems like the Robin managed to get through that pretty cleanly, so.
Yeah, it was kind of a lazy spin right in front of him, and he kind of quickly went to the other side of the track. Isaac Price connecting to the server, so I presume Robin will be pitting in at the end of this lap on end of 3-4-0. So it looks like we are on a 27 lap per hour pace.
Joe is timing out, I believe. He has 25 second lag at the moment.
Yes, that's right, Joe Letteriello. Time's out. And Tommy Osgard in just before the timeout. And I think that's one thing that was mentioned fairly sufficiently earlier, that, you know, with the new slightly higher tolerance before someone times out, if you see it quickly, you can recover pretty quickly.
Yeah, I think that's a good thing with the latest update. So you have a bit higher or bigger margin to actually notice something is wrong before it disconnects you from the actual server. In case there's just a couple of packet losses, which just makes you lag for a bit, it doesn't disconnect you right away. Once it settles again, you can still continue without any problems. So that's a good thing.
Robin Friscott has handed over the lead car of NX Racing to Isaac Price, who leaves the pits and gets on his way. A routine pit stop, it would seem, now.
So, Timo, if you don't mind sharing, how long might we see Isaac in the car for now? How much longer before someone else other than Isaac or Robin pilots the machine?
Well, it's gonna be for another couple of stints at least, until we get Monty and Mikko to wake up. So, until that, it's gonna be Isaac and Robin just switching or swapping each stint, so. I think Matti is supposed to be here in about 2 or 3 hours, tops.
And I observe on your race roster, you've got Simon Cattell and yourself on it. I presume Will Simon actually partake in proceedings? Or is he just a backup, sort of?
Yes, that's correct. Both him and me are here as a standby backup drivers in case something goes wrong with the drivers that are supposed to do the whole race. I think we have a battle for 5th position actually, between Stig Breeding Pro and Conquest Pro. Yes, it seems like Piotr Boyk, the Conquest car, is a bit further into his stint, so we should get around the Stig Breeding car pretty easy. We just came out of the pits a couple of laps ago.
It is still close between Goik and Morbay. Goik, I think, kind of took a little bit of an excursion at the chicane, so I think he partly let Morbay back through just to make sure he couldn't be construed as gaining time while being off. This time using the slipstream to get around and staying away so Morbay cannot get much of a comeback slipstream. Oh, and a car off up ahead there. Wong, it looked like. He's getting himself out of the grip. He has Mr. Hall ready to take over from him here at the end of the. Say though that a safety car would kind of give everyone a nice bit of a break from just the constant flat out flavor of things, but it would definitely wake people up on them.
Yeah, absolutely, definitely. It would be nice from a spectator point of view, of course, but personally, since my teammates are in the lead, I personally would not want to see that. Well, since so many times, it's a long race, and I guess it happens, so it wouldn't surprise me if you see one.
And Matt Kingsbury has gone off at turn 9. Klaus, the left-hand wall, is a bit of a... I'm actually surprised none of the XRRs have tipped it over at turn 9 on that hike.
Yeah, I think people have learned to stay away from that.
Can I offer an opinion? Good morning, everybody. Jonathan, the last time you said out loud that a safety car would be beneficial to the race, someone crashed on purpose. You remember that? So, anyone listening, please do not crash, at least on purpose.
Are you talking about something that happened in Elville many years ago?
Might be. Now, if someone tips over an XRR, it's probably they will claim afterwards that you told them to do that.
Would that mean that I could protest the race director?
As far as I know, you can protest him now. Not gonna do any good, but
so Timo, will we see you driving any oval races this year?
Well, hopefully not.
Hopefully not.
Come on. A couple of years ago when I did my last oval race online, then I got crashed quite a lot of times.
It's oval, isn't that what it's about? Crashing each other?
Yeah, I don't really see the point in that. I'd rather just race. But I suppose racing could be fun.
Yeah, what's better than watching
the same way
35 team
your
racers?
Exam could be fun. Never
True.
Tried it. Could be fun.
And the R needs to host an event where the guy who crashes the most would win. We could put Isaac and Nicky there and they could fight it out for the win.
Didn't Nico Puntolo win something this year or last year?
I think he won the 500, didn't he?
Yeah, but. Well, yes. There you go then. The person who crashed the most won.
Touché.
No, in all seriousness, credit where credit is due, Nico drove a great race, but there were some incidents involved, if I recall correctly.
Yeah, I can. It must be hell to administrate those sort of races when people really don't seem to care about anything else than wrecking with each other, and you spend more than half of the race on the safety car.
I suppose if you were to organize a big oval race, then Deco will probably recommend you a very good therapist.
I don't even.
Can we get back to the racing today? What's occurring on track? I have no idea.
Not too much at the moment, actually. It's pretty quiet and spread out again. I can't really see any sort of close battles anywhere on the track.
According to Trakra, the Eleven and 21 cars should be quite close to each other. Not on track, but...
Yeah, that's Conquest and State Breeding Program. And Conquest is about 50 minutes into this thing, while State Breeding Car is only 20, so... I can't really see the State Car catching Conquest. This point, I think we watched that. Watched Conquest overtake them just a few minutes ago.
Right, there is also the LLM amateur car and also the Green Angus car, about 10 seconds apart.
Say Vortex has actually done a pretty good comeback during the race, up to 12th from being dead last after the first two laps, to being involved in a start crash and Seb going off in turn 9. Of course, there's still I think a couple of laps down off the leaders, but still. Getting up to 12 is pretty good, and there's still a long way to go.
Anyway, I'm gonna get myself some rest for a few hours.
You can't leave us here.
I really must. I'm afraid. But hopefully, I'll see you all when I return.
Have a good night.
Ah, sweet dreams, there, Steve.
Don't crash into any safety cars.
I'll try. Take care, guys.
Ciao.
And then there were three. Right, someone is in fact lagging at the moment. Quite badly.
And it's gone. Peter Goik of Gunkwell.
Yeah, that's the Congress car timing out. And
yeah, they were running in 5th place. Still on their lead lap, I believe. So
right, I think Goik is timing out again. Garbalevsky has also joined. Bake. Beal. Yeah, the Stick Breeders were in fact just seconds behind Conquest, so they'll be losing the fifth position overall.
Oh, look.
Well, everyone's here now. We have a Boothie, and we have a Joe Littery.
It's a Boothie.
Hi, Joe.
Hi.
How you doing, buddy?
Hey, bud, how you doing, bud?
Hey, bud, how you doing?
Pretty good race, huh, bud?
Yeah, sure.
How was your race? How was your race been?
Fun. Until my internet pooped.
Oh, no.
Actually has been too bad, and everyone's actually been pretty clean.
Where are you guys running right now?
I think we were running 11th. I think we're like 15th? 14th. Beginning of the race, Thorsten spun twice, I believe. We went from 12th to 5th, and then he got spun out of Boothie chicane.
That sucks. I believe you have Tommy in the car right now. I think he's done some pretty good progress, from what I've seen.
Yeah. He's pretty much the main guy. It's what we were doing is all the European guys, obviously, during the daytime, and then me and him right now during the night, and then for the rest of the race, it's going to be all the European guys again.
Yeah, so will we see Christoph or Reno in the car as well during tomorrow or today?
No. Reno? Stu, a possibility. Christy, no. Reno might race at the end tomorrow. Not entirely sure.
Yeah, it's quite dead on the track again. Or, well, it has been for quite a while.
It's been quite boring,
It's zombie mode for everyone right now. Just trying to manage to get through these hard hours.
Ooh, Matt came for his, knocked out some tires in the booty chicane.
So, Joe, how much more are you going to drive today? Couple of stints?
Yeah, probably it's going to be me and him going back and forth every hour into like 7:30 or 8 in the morning UTC. I think I'm going to do like 6 or 7 total stints the whole race.
Yeah, that's quite a lot. How are you feeling? You exhausted already, or you still feel fresh?
It's only 11:30 my time, so I'm pretty good.
Oh, I envy you right now. I wish I had your energy.
And I also have 4 energy drinks and pizza and food.
Well, you are a fat American, so that's nothing new.
Thank you.
You're welcome, bud.
So has there really been any close race in this whole race, other than the little bit of Isaac and Nikki I've seen?
Yeah, there has. There actually has been quite a lot. Quite many lead changes due to team having various problems with the wheels and disconnects and stuff like that. But it's been kind of quiet for a couple of hours now. People are pretty spread out.
Yeah, I think it was about 2 stints ago when Tommy got in the car, he had like a minute gap to the guy in front of him. He said it was probably the most boring stint he's ever drove.
Yeah, it's really hard when you're in that position, when you're kind of in a no man's land. You can't really see the guy in front and you don't have anyone chasing you. So you're all driving all by yourself and it's a bit harder to keep the concentration then. It's easier if you see someone close to you that you are catching, for example, every lap. It'll be easier to drive then.
It's been a pretty consistent race for the top 5. I don't think they've changed much. Actually, it's been consistent for the whole freaking race. So when's Phil getting here? I thought he was coming around sooner or later.
I thought he was coming.
Told me that he would be here at some point of the race, he just didn't know when. Hoping that he joins us for the last part of the race.
So the whole super secret thing of yesterday will not be shown, Deca?
It might be.
Some interesting statistics or data from Michael Booth regarding the tire in the Boothie chicane is that InSim has recorded 962 hits to the tires up to midnight UTC. Oh, no, sorry, 0300 UTC, so 12 hours, almost 1,000 times.
Wow.
Also, another piece of interesting information. The reason why you couldn't hear LFS sounds on the stream, which we apologize for, the person responsible for that was, in fact, Safety Car Steve, so blame him.
Oh, there has been no sound at all for all this time?
Just for a little while.
Since he left, I guess.
There's only been that one safety car of the car flipping, right? There's been no more?
I was told there were two, but
yeah, there was one earlier, I think. I was away then, but I only heard that there was one, and then the second one with the flipped car.
That's not too bad, only two.
Yeah, I mean, it's the way the rescue cars have handled the beach cars has been really good.
Is this the first time for doing that? Going out and get it during the race?
No, it's happened before. By the way, drive to the penalty car 57, avoidable exit car 21. Also shortly coming, DT02, avoidable contact with car 69, and also DT car 62 for avoidable incident with car 0.
And interestingly, some of the protests didn't take no more than about 4 hours to be reviewed.
Well, that's always fun. I mean, at least it keeps you busy.
Oh, I'm perfectly capable of keeping myself busy.
I see what you did there. So quite interesting that second place car fires as a drive through now. I'm not quite sure exactly how much in time it would be here, but I would presume something like 15 seconds.
Well, presumably Hillen will be able to pass him, but
yes, pretty easy. Let's see how far behind is.
Big breeders are quite far behind, yeah. They're not gonna make it,
no. Helen goes past James Peace. Okay, so only 10 hours and 22 minutes remaining, ish. This is becoming a sprint race pretty soon.
Possibly. No, I'm almost starting to regret the fact that I missed the first, what, 7-8 hours.
Well, I've seen some people were driving like it was a sprint race earlier in the race. Doing some aggressive moves here and there. Actually, it's been, for me, when I'm getting lapped, people are quite nice and clean about it. So are you going to drive Teemu? Are you not going to set a lap?
Negative, Ghost Rider. I am just a backup for this. Even if I wanted to, I probably wouldn't be able to. My hands have been shaking way too much today.
And the cause for that is?
A hard night.
So you're not racing, but is Simon Cantell gonna make an appearance?
I very much doubt that. He's kinda in the same position as I am. We're both here just in case something happens to the regular drivers. But you never know.
Never know. Maybe Isaac's internet will allow you to race.
I hope it doesn't.
Current NX is the only car on the lead lap, or...?
No, it's just a tracker, no? that's...
Okay, yeah, I was about to say.
I believe the last car on the lead lap is...
Or number two, perhaps?
No, it's further up than that. I think we see where he's done.
Fifth.
Isaac is coming up to lap Elton Chong, who's sixth. Well, not coming up, but he has about, I would say, 5-6 seconds up to Elton.
Ooh, geez.
Who's in sixth at the moment. But yeah, still pretty good, only one retirement.
That's not bad at all.
Pretty good. 5 out of 5. So Boothie, do you have any more interesting statistics for us from the race?
Not really. It's almost 5 a.m. so we need to pay in a minute. Like 5 o'clock.
You as well? What's wrong with everyone?
I need sleep.
Well, I need to sleep as well. But you don't see me leaving, do you?
I need to come back for when Deco almost falls asleep at whatever it is, 10 o'clock in the morning his time.
Jesus, you're a bunch of girls.
If I can make it another 4 hours for all the Europeans to come back, I should be good. Since it'll get more active and it'll keep me.
Yeah, this is such a hard part of the race when it's barely happening anything and it's just running in zombie mode in the head, just trying to stay awake.
That was awkward.
What have you done?
Well, if you've noticed, I left really quick. I'm sitting here and I hear Tommy yelling in the background that he's out of fuel. He's about to come down pits. And somehow the car just turned off. Not even sure what happened.
Must be hacks.
Is that the good old Nigel Mansell who turned the car off at Canada? F1 race thing. He said it was a mechanical failure, but he must have just pressed I.
If his hand moved over and hit I, then he's got the problems. Who knows, maybe he was about to set a fast lap, got a boner, and hit I, so things happen.
We have a car in the gravel at turn 8. He's slowly working his way out.
There's one for turn 2 as well.
Oh, yeah, that is turn 2. Sorry, I looked totally like turn 8 from the angle.
very nicely makes sure that the track is completely clear before rejoining. Very smart, especially when you get stuck or end up out of the track in a place like that. Very, very high speed corner, which is kind of blindish when you come around it.
Well, if you guys have not noticed, there are some cars out there with green visors. They are the amateur class. Same restrictions.
Right now we're looking at Matt Kingsbury.
That's Matt Kingsbury. He wrecked a few times, poor guy. Bad luck with that team, but they're pushing through. They're in the amateur class. Bad luck. It's a shame. On a more serious note, though, LLM is reforming their team pretty nicely, having some nice drivers on the AM Pro. They won their last race at Westfield, didn't they? The AM car, LLM.
I'm not quite sure.
I know they got a podium, so that's not good. And then Stig Pridium program is Bazinga, I believe? From GT2?
Could be, yeah.
I think they are.
Yeah, I mean, well, they already showed what they can do in GT2 World Series. When they drove on the Bazinga name. What was that? Yeah, that was GT. No, was that Super GT? Can't remember.
Not sure, but I'm pretty sure Infinity Esports Pro went off turn one. I don't know if you've seen that. I believe he did. He's got right side damage. Gwyk is timing out again.
I think, Joe, you'll notice that that's actually the left side of the car.
Is it? No, I'm looking at the F10. He's got visible damage on the left side, but he's got actual damage on the right side. Now, I know I'm American.
Are you a wizard?
Next, Chris Devoto.
Wait a minute, so you're a girl? A female?
I wish not the answer.
So, I take it that as a yes.
Thank you.
got Hellenic Racing Team 3 laps down. State breeding program 27 seconds behind Hellenic Racing Team. And overall 12th position behind state breeding program. We have Green Angus Racing 2 laps behind those two. We have Last Laugh Motorsports, who wreck a lot. And we have Infinity Esports AM right behind Last Laugh Motorsports, 0.81 seconds behind them to be exact. Savage Sim Sports number 1, a minute and 1. Okay, I'm bad at this, I'm sorry. I gotta go get ready for my stint.
Normally let you into this coach box.
I understand why.
I'm not good at anything, I'm sorry.
No.
It's just not American at all.
Hey, buddy.
I would like to pronounce the name of the Infinity Esports AM driver, but I have no idea how to pronounce it.
Hajin.
The unpronounceable man is listening on Matt Kingsbury.
I'm going to pronounce him as Hajin Yuk. Is that good enough?
That's what I was going to say, but I had a feeling I'd get yelled at.
I would like to apologize for this interruption, any more fun and games here, ladies, but we need to make a quick break in the stream here to try and keep it as close to 2.5 hours as we can. It will be just a couple of seconds, though. That is all the respite you. Stay with us, please.